Hi, good evening. Welcome. I'd like to introduce myself and my colleague. My name is Kiyoka Koizumi. I'm on the faculty in the Department of Health and Nutrition Sciences at the Brooklyn College, City University of New York. And I'm also this survey that we are presenting tonight is done in the group called JAA, Japanese American Association. And we are, both of us are committee members, Asian committee we named it. And we have done a research surveying the elderly people in New York area, which is the first one done in the history of Japanese in the New York tri-state area, and with the sponsorship and then actually from the request of the Japanese consulate. So let me give the microphone to Ms. Aileen Yamaguchi. Would you like to introduce yourself?
My name is Aileen Yamaguchi. I'm a retired psychiatric occupational therapist. I'm born and raised in California and educated all of it in California, except I got my master's in public health at University of Hawaii. Work-wise, I've worked mainly in California, here in New York also, and then also in Japan for over 13 years. What happened is when the Japanese government passed the opening of occupational physical therapy schools, we American therapists were the first ones who went and started the schools. So I started the second OT school in Tokyo. And since then, I'm back in New York, living here since I returned from Kyushu in Japan. And I've been here since 1988, working and then retired, and very active, involved. I'm a board member of the Japanese American Association of New York. And also volunteer with the senior citizen programs there. And also, I don't know how many of you have heard of the Japanese American Citizens League, which is the largest Asian American civil rights group. And we have chapters all across the United States. And I'm the president for the New York chapter, JACL. So I'll kind of leave it at that.
So we are going to share with you. We'd like to share the survey results that was done. Now, would you, before I start, would you like to make some comments or some introduction?
Okay. I didn't know other than what Ms. Koizumi had told me that you were interested in the particular survey that we accomplished in regards to aging issues amongst the Japanese and Japanese Americans. And I was involved with this from the beginning, and then, in fact, Mrs. Koizumi and I worked on the English translation, et cetera, of this. Let me just ask, before I go on with my spiel, what areas of this interests you, so that when we go into question and answer, whether I can answer it or not, I'm just interested, what areas of this interests each of you? Or any of it? Is there anything specific that you are interested in, or just wait until we do this stuff? Okay. All right. Okay.
All right. Then shall we?
Yeah. Why don't you just go ahead and do
all
that
right.
then?
Uh-huh. Okay. That's the other title of the survey, and at least that's the translation. The original survey was done, the survey format was both in Japanese and English. However, original summary and report was done in Japanese, and it was translated later on into English. And our names are there. Ms. Shindo will be joining us soon. And all of us are on the JAA committee, that's Japanese American Association Committee on Aging Issues. Actually, our office is on the block away from here. Okay. Now, the number of Japanese in the greater New York area. Now, the greater New York area, as it says there, includes New York State, New Jersey, Connecticut, and Pennsylvania. And according to the Consulate General of Japan, as of October 1st, 2005, the total number of the Japanese, that's the number according to the Consulate General of Japan, 59,298 people. And then actually this is the largest number within all the Japanese embassies and consulates, actually throughout the world. So this area has the largest Japanese population, according to official data of the Japanese government. Okay, now the next chart shows the number of Japanese and Japanese Americans in New York area, and then what it shows is the point we'd like to make in this chart, or actually the table, is you can see the percentage of the Japanese in each state compared to the total population. It's extremely small. It's of course less than, as you can see, less than 1%, but New York that has the largest is 0.24%. And when it comes to Pennsylvania, as you can see, 0.09%. So we are actually, if we combine all together, we are not the minority. However, it actually is, according to the Federation of Asian Federation in New York City, we are the seventh minorities in the New York area, total. However, one of the interesting aspects of the Japanese is that we are kind of spread apart and scattered around. And as you probably know, that we don't have any Japanese town. There's no Japantown around here, and which is an interesting thing. And then that actually is related to I think we understand it when we think about the history, what kind of immigrants came to New York area compared to, say, Brazil or California. The most of the immigrants to a California, South America area were the farmers and fishermen. And then, however, New York area, it was pretty much the business people and then also the government officials and the exchange students, etc. Okay, so let's see. Now, the Asian population here, this is our interest. The percentage of Japanese and Japanese Americans over 65, right? Now, we looked at in the previous table. The previous table showed that the Japanese are minority. And how about the older population? Well, the same situation applies. Among those over 65, again, you can see that the percentage is less than 1% for all these states. So in other words, that the total, regardless to the age group, Japanese are still minority, and especially since it seems like the Japanese have a habit of living not in a area with the Japanese alone, such as basically Japanese town, like Chinese people may have Chinatown, but then we don't. And so you can see the result there. All right, let's see the next one. Why is it important to discuss about aging issues among Japanese and Japanese Americans? Why are we interested in all of a sudden? Well, actually, the Japanese government started to be very interested in, and then they backed up with the capital, with the funding for this research. And then a few of the Japanese American, JAA, Japanese American Association members, several years back, started to be very extremely interested in this aging issue in among New York area Japanese. And that's how this whole survey got started. Well, let's see, number one, the number of Japanese Americans. Well, this one is, I think I already mentioned, that the total number is not small. In other words, that if we combine everyone, that this area ranks, the Japanese ranks the seventh among all the minorities. However, we are scattered. And so that's one issue. And second issue, second point is that, among us, just like in Japan, aging population is increasing. The big group that came after the World War II as business people, that is a big wave of immigration after the war with the bubble economy, etc. That group, many of them went back, but then some of them are staying here. And also the other types of group, like the artist group. They are those who are staying, and this group is basically is aging. Well, in Japan, the Japanese government started to be extremely interested in us as well. Before, they had this attitude of, well, you guys just left Japan, so, you know, don't bother us, that kind of attitude. But then now, the government seems to be, Japanese government seems to take an interest in the population overseas, because they wanted to grasp who is where, and are they coming back to Japan, and they use the insurance in Japan or not? Or do we have to care for the welfare of the Japanese abroad? So the culture of the government, the way they think, seems to be shifting slightly, which is good for us who live overseas. And let's see, still the second point, aging population is increasing. Now, this aging group, as we grow older, when you're young, the language, some people say, wasn't a problem. Right, you make friends without the language, and some people marry without being able to communicate with the same language. But then, as we grow older, people started to notice that actually, I don't like the second language. I feel more comfortable with a mother tongue, and also when we are young, we didn't really care whether we have white rice, that sticky rice or not. And as we grow older, it seems like some of us really get nostalgic to Japanese culture and the food. And those voices are heard from the Japanese people who live around here. And then as I introduced this JAA, Japanese American Association group, is getting more active. And then they have somebody who answers the phone all the time. And so they get to hear what kind of concerns the average citizen, Japanese, who live around here do have. And then, of course, aging is a normal process. However, oftentimes we forget. We have to get ready for it, because as we grow old, naturally, our physical condition may not be as ideal as we once were or would like to be. When you are young, generally we are pretty much illness-free, and we don't have to go to the doctor. As we grow, one of the drawbacks of aging, there are a lot of benefits in aging process. However, we have few things that we have to be careful with, which is that we may have more, some of us started to have chronic conditions, which requires medical care much more so than when we're young. However, oftentimes we just are not prepared. And then it may cost more money, but then we just do not have the money put aside. So these are the issues that became the center of the before we made the committee made a decision to go through this survey, right? So the purpose of the survey, these are the main ones, to identify demographic trends of Japanese and Japanese Americans age 50 and older living in New York, New Jersey, Connecticut, and Pennsylvania, and to explore their levels of awareness of aging issues, such as, you know, where do you want to live? What are your concerns? Are you ready for your, your old age, such as, do you have a will? Do you have a healthcare proxy? Do you have enough put aside for your after your for your retirement, etc. Okay.
Now,
the survey methods. Survey sheets were created by the committee of the aging committee of the JAA, Japanese American Association. And it was developed using the survey form from the California's Japanese American Association. And then along with the some of the advice from the consulate and then from the committee members, etc., it was modified. And it came to this both English and Japanese survey instrument. And the subjects, the people who got these, it was mailed out. And to who? Now, Japanese and Japanese Americans living in New York area, how do you find them? Well, basically, these are the people whose names were reported in the consulate. And so they had all these individuals' names. And they also those people who are members of the JAA in New York City, as well as there's JAA in Princeton, there's JAA in Buffalo, Philadelphia. So all these members were notified, and then whoever the Japanese American Association had addressed, they did send to.
Can I also add to that?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Also, the subjects were taken from the various organizations within the New York area, like JACL, the Japanese American United Church, the Buddhist Church, so religious and civic organizations also. We used all that address list.
Okay. So now, let's see. It was collected, it was the survey was done last year in January and February 2006. And the distribution number was, as it says there, 8,196. And 15 out of that, 1517 were returned. And the 30%, a little over 30% return rate. So the 2026 survey forms were returned after being answered. Okay. Then some of the results we'd like to introduce to you. Now, the out of the 2026 returned, 1882 were usable. We had to eliminate a few of them. As you can see, there 113 were under 49, and then they actually answered. And 19 people did not specify their age. And then 12 people did not specify gender, so we had to eliminate them. And then the age breakdown is, as you can see there, 50 to 64, and then over 65, right? We divided this way because 50 to 64, we called them like preparation to advanced age, something over that line, and then the over 65 elderly. Okay, and then male and female, that is the number of the different gender. Now, let's see. This page is missing from your handout, I believe. So I'd like you to just look at the slide here. Now, the area of residence, the New York City is the one that has most number of people who live in this area, 41%, 41.2%. And next one is northern part of New Jersey, that's 18%. And among the New York City, when you look at the five boroughs, of course Manhattan, we don't have that data there, but the breakdown of that 41.2% is Manhattan, of course, is the has the largest, about 60% of the New York City residents live in Manhattan. And then the Queen, Brooklyn, Bronx, Staten Island, in that order. Okay. Now, status in the United States. Now, Japanese are pretty much legal residents, I believe, here, at least the ones who replied. Illegal residents, it says 0%, but then actually we didn't have a chance to put it down there. But then there were five people who answered here in the survey who are actually have no paper. And as you can see, many of them are green card holders, permanent residents, 75%. And then actually one quarter are US citizens. And out of these US citizens, most of them are Japan-born, born in Japan, and then got the citizenship here. About three quarters, 75% of those US citizens were born in Japan, but then acquired citizenship here. And one quarter are the ones who are born here and then have Japanese citizenship, like Miss Yamaguchi here.
No, does not have Japanese citizenship. We don't have Japanese citizenship.
Oh, you don't?
No, there's no need to. I'm an American citizen. So Japanese Americans who were born here automatically, obviously, are Americans.
Okay.
So it's an error to say that we have Japanese citizenship.
Okay. All right.
Then
that is going to be a Then a U.S. citizen. Then those are the ones that now the now I just found out with that breakdown we did not survey. Out of these one quarter of the American-born Japanese, then the any of them are. Well, if they're U.S. citizens, that's right, then you do not have Japanese citizenship.
That's right.
Exactly.
No,
that's right.
That's
okay.
Incorrect.
Okay, I'm sorry. All right.
I'm sorry.
Okay, that's right. Okay, now, educational background and language preferences. Now, this is quite interesting. As you can see that you probably all knew that Japanese are pretty much educated, you know, back home, of course, but then among the people who are here, as you can see, the over 50%, 52.2% are college graduate or even they went to graduate school. This percentage is extremely high than actually Japanese in Japan or compared to other minority groups here. So the Japanese who live in New York area are quite educated. And then their language preference, when it was asked, which language do you prefer? Many of them, actually, about half of them said that they prefer to speak Japanese. And then about 40% said both. They're competent in both. And the English, that's 10%, right? Now, this sounds pretty fine. However, this Japanese, the people who said that, that they prefer Japanese, if they're going to stay in this country in their old age, this can be a handicap because they started to have more legal issues or medical problems, and how are they going to have a conversation and then have their wishes conveyed to the caretakers, to the medical doctors, etc., etc. Okay, so that's one of the things. Okay, then our marital status. Are we married or not in this country, in New York, I'm sorry, in New York area? As you can see, this the New York metropolitan area, many of the people who are over 50 are married, as you can see, 68%. However, there are those, then the 40% are not. And we are talking about the for those who are over 50, right? Let's see, singles are, that percentage is about 10%, 10.5. Divorce separated about 10, also 10.5%. Widow, widower, another 10%. Okay, now, if you look at the right side, it says high rates of singles. Now, the in New York City, the New York City, the singles of all these states combined, it was 10%, as you can see on the pie chart. But if you look at New York City, it's much higher. In New York City, about 45.5% of the residents of New York City are single. And then these are those people who are over 50.
When you say single, you're not referring to marital status, right? When you say
single,
it has nothing to do with marital status. Right? It has to do with living alone.
This one is single.
It is single.
The marital
status.
Right.
Interruption.
Okay, it is marital status, yeah. Okay. High rates of divorce in New York City is another one. On the pie chart, that is 10%, but in New York City, that's another one that is high, that's 16%. And then suburbs have a, we don't have the percentage right here, but widowhood is actually high. It's
actually, like Long Island, 13%, and Connecticut could be is as high as 17%. Now, the living situation, housing and the living situation. You can look through the purple, the blue and the purple. The blue one is self-owned, and then the purple one is family-owned. So combining those two, you can see that many of these older Japanese people in this area do own their own home, or they live in the family home, right? Which is pretty good news. The only one different is New York City. The 45% of the people who live in New York City in the Japanese are renting their own residence. Okay, and then now let's look at the percentage at the right side. Living arrangement. The total number 1882 people whom we surveyed, actually 25.3% actually live alone. Now, in New York City, actually 40% live alone. So in New York City, as you can see, very high percentage of those who live alone and who rent their own home. Now, this becomes one of the concerns when these people become older. They're alone, and then they are renting, and are they rent controlled, etc. These issues are one of our interests to follow up. Okay. Now, the live with someone, 74% live, that is the total out of the 1882 people. And then who do they live with? Those are the percentages, spouse, partner, children, etc. Okay. Now, next one is a source of income. And then this is nothing surprising. Many of the people surveyed, about 60%, they are basically salarymen, we call, employment wages. And then this one is the multiple answers were allowed. That's why the percentage is there. So some people still work while collecting Social Security, or the spouse's income, spouse may be working, or some of them collect the Japanese pension while they work here. Now, health insurance. Now, this is nothing surprising to see that the Medicare, 85.3% do have Medicare, which is pretty good, that they're pretty much aware of the system and using it. Now, many of the people do have health insurance by the employer, 61%. Now, our main concern here, looking at this chart, is the group that is no insurance. It's 12.9% of those who are 50 to 64. And this is a little concern for ours, because in the 50s and 60s, before the Medicare kicks in, just like any other population, that's a time that chronic disease may start. And then the early intervention becomes very crucial. If they are pre-diabetic, they need to be discovered. They need to be told that they have to be careful with their eating and diet and then exercise, etc. And so that is actually our main concern here. Okay. Now here, current and future concerns. These are the this is the answer to the question, what are your concerns? Current, what are you worried about now? Or what are your future concerns? Now, what's the biggest? You can see right in the middle, inability to care for self, and then also financial resources. Those are the two main concerns, which is not a surprise. Okay. Then preparation for future aging needs. Are you prepared for these issues? That was the question. Now, do you have a will? That was the one first question. Those who are younger group, 50 to 64, About one quarter said yes, a little over a quarter. Now, for older group, more than half said they do. But it means the rest do not. We all should have will. But then, so this is good news, like half of the elderly do have, but then where's the other half? That is the, our question. And the healthcare proxy, both groups becomes much lower. Okay, and it's as important as the will. You know, in today's medical atmosphere. Now, the financial planning is another one that we found it very interesting. Now, let's see, for younger group, do have more financial planning done than the older group. 40% has financial planning. That is great. They have to worry about their future. However, that means where's the other 60% has no financial planning? Right, so that's something that we do need to convey a message to our fellow Japanese population in this area, the importance of these issues, and then also provide assistance if they do not know what to do and where to go to prepare for this. Now, to the question, if you become unable to care for yourself, how would you like to be cared for? In other words, where do you want to go? Do you want to go to a nursing home? Are you going back to Japan? That was the question. Now, the first group, 57.3% replied, stay home and being cared for by family members or by using home care services. They want to stay in their own home. That was the biggest chunk of the response. And the second one was go to a nursing facility that is Japanese specific. In other words, that the nursing home that will provide Japanese food, you know, the in the morning with the miso soup and then white rice and et cetera, and then somebody who care with the nursing staff who speak Japanese. That was the another big percentage that we saw. Now, to the question, are you going back to Japan after all? Because Japan has the health insurance for the aged for the last 30 years. And then now we have this long-term care program starting, let's see, was it 1994, which is over 10 years or so. So are you going back to Japan? To that question, yes, said 16%. No, about 29% have no idea, haven't decided. So this group is the one that may actually want to go back. And so that's one of the reasons this Japanese government started to put the money into the survey. They have to kind of figure out, where are these Japanese who are abroad? Are they coming back or are they going to be staying in another country? That is their interest. Okay, so now to summarize, what we found were that there are differences in the city and suburbs in New York area. In the city, of course, it's much easier to shop and hospital is nearby, transportation is available, you don't have to own a car. But then many of the Japanese people who live in New York City are renting and they're living alone, they're single, and that is a concern as a Japanese community. And then for the people who live in the suburbs, many of them are married and they own home, but then they have inconvenience of, they have to drive to go anywhere, they have to go shopping, and when they are older, what are they going to do? So there are different issues, depends on where these Japanese elderly live. Now, the health insurance for people age 50 to 60. This is nothing unique to Japanese, but the Japanese population also falls to this problem of, okay, if the work doesn't provide health insurance and then the Medicare doesn't kick in, or you don't have the job, then where do you get the health insurance? So therefore, we have 12.9% of these people who are near elderly age group with no insurance. And that's something is, again, something that we would like to pay attention to and see whether there's anything that could be done. And then request of home health care and nursing home. That was the desire expressed by the respondents of the survey. However, originally what we were expecting was there would be an overwhelming request to have established a nursing home, a Japanese nursing home, with the Japanese food, the Japanese music, Japanese speaking person, staff members, etc. But then when we opened this result, it was more of the home health care that Japanese people wanted. So we are planning a next survey, and we would like to ask more in detail about exactly what they're wishing for. Are you going to come into the nursing home if we have one, etc.
Okay.
Now, the Japanese citizenship, are we going back or are we staying? This is very much of the interest of the actually Japanese government.
Okay.
Let's see. Then as Japanese American Japanese American Association's Aging Committee, what are we to do now? That has been our discussion. And the one thing that we came to conclusion is we need to educate our group, especially on aging issues. And then how do we educate them? Well, we can use Japanese newspaper, Japanese TV, and then we have this wonderful technology these days, the internet. And that way we could reach the homebound elderly as well. So that is one. And then the necessity of the another survey to look into more detail some of the things that we did miss. And we learned quite a bit with the first survey. And so what we do know what we have to do in the second survey. So that summarizes our survey result. Okay, so we'd like to see whether any of you would like to ask any questions, or Aileen-san, would you like to?
Yeah, maybe I would just add,
okay.
Now that the results of the survey are given, just as a follow-up from the survey, what the Committee on Aging has been doing is we've been making a lot of visits to senior homes, like Isabella, Salvation Army residences. So we've been making a lot of visits, Queens, etc. Also in Jersey, sometime we've gone 2-3 times to the same facility, and many of our senior citizens, anybody can request to go with us. We usually get 20 to 25 people at each visit. And of course, it depends on the facility, because many of them are small. But we've been making very regular tours and getting information from these senior homes. Another thing, Ms. Koizumi mentioned that health education is important, and we've been very actively following up with that. The Kiyoka, the twice a month senior lunches that are held right across here. After the luncheon, the luncheons are held twice a month. After the luncheon, after some Japanese cultural musical presentation, there's always a health education lecture given in around prevention, because we have 3-4 Japanese speaking doctors who are retired. So we are always giving health education information. Let's see. Also, a lot of discussions have gone into this result of, do you want to go back to Japan? And if so, what would that be like for you? And I know, because I'm a volunteer, I do a lot of individual discussions and some consultations that come up. And the issues that come up is, you know, I came here with my husband. He was a kaisha company person. He's passed away. And I've continued to live here on my own. And many of these widows we've found have been well taken care of by their husbands when he was alive, and kept very, in a sense, dependent. So many of the women, the widows, didn't even know how to write a check. A lot of just everyday needs they needed assistance with, and also because of the language problem. So those are educational services we provide, bilingual consultations. The doctors and I also do that. Also referrals to mental health facilities if needed, mainly around some individual referrals. And I've worked in psychiatry over 40 years, so I can't do any counseling, but I'm somewhat aware of what kind of needs a person may have. Let's see. And the area about the need for bilingual health educators, health persons, there is, the Japanese consulate has an organization of Japanese health professionals that meet regularly, and that's also a part of a follow-up to this study. So they're available. We are now down to one person.
Kumazu just have a discussion with him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think we should just communicate with you. And your Michio Hirai-san, eh?
One of the aspects,
right.
I think it's based on findings
right.
conducted the survey. And, so the two aspects of the education regarding aging issue, that means that disseminate the survey finding to the participant or over 60 or senior and citizen around the tri-states or this area. So I think it is very important because actually myself, it is my first time. And strike me, it's a quite a variety of areas I'm much aware of because I'm still working, so it's my energy mostly concentrated on working. But at the same time, it is very, very important and even critical, must be aware. But most of people, I suppose, and probably too busy for daily life, then the survey findings would be a very good instrument to advocate what that you have to aware of in your future life, whether finance, housing, and also finance, etc. Probably one of the action items.
Right.
At the same time, need to survey. Does that mean it's something in-depth survey or cutting at a different area? Because I used to work in the marketing research professional, so it would be very interesting to see what aspect of needs of a survey. It's another survey, same survey or something more segmented survey? Because important thing is how we structureize or drive an action solution. Because it is very important, aging and Japanese American society around here. So, but at the same time, it is not easy. I know it's not easy, and maybe we don't have the simple answer. Probably first step is networking. And then continuously and feed up-to-date information regarding your future, and consistently and drive an awareness for the Japanese citizen for a Japanese American citizen around this area. Mm-hmm. Probably it will be one of the immediate action we have to consider for.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I appreciate your point.
It is a very good survey.
Yeah.
And learned a lot.
Yeah. No, thank you for your comments, Hirai-san. Are you a Nisei?
Pardon?
Are you a Nisei?
No, I'm a Japanese.
You're Japanese?
Yes.
But you've lived here for many years.
Yes, it's almost 11 years now.
Okay.
In mostly in New York area.
Okay. No, because your first point about need to disseminate the information, I'm glad you brought that up, because when this was completed, and because as Mrs. Koizumi has mentioned, much of the funding and interest was from the Japanese consulate, so the original results are written in Japanese and presented to the Japanese consulate, but it has never been presented to the English-speaking community.
Are
you aware of the Japanese American Citizens League, JACL? Mm-hmm. And I'm the president for the New York chapter. We have been thinking of the JACL with JAA and possibly other groups, and mainly that we would take the leadership. And we need to give this information back to the Japanese American community. That has not been done. So that is something that we in the JCL, my New York chapter, have been thinking about, and do this PowerPoint display, et cetera. So I appreciate you saying that, because we do need to do that. The other is providing a way, again, because I happen to be with JCL, of providing opportunities, and probably we'll do meetings around health issues. The national JACL is always has had a lot of emphasis on health, but currently is putting more of a emphasis on health across the United States. And so we here, as a follow-up to this, we're thinking of doing like health proxies, et cetera, and start providing that through our JCL chapter events. So
at the same time, I think it's a state government or federal government. They also have addressed aging population.
Right.
Probably some common and concern.
Right.
But fortunately, it's translated English. So maybe we could make a presentation and make possible to share some of the action.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Right,
I'm saying that the JACL, we are planning to do this, to present this to the Japanese American community. Mm-hmm. Obviously, it's open to anybody, but we have not presented the Japanese American, the Japanese, the English, to the community. The Japanese results of the survey has been presented in bits and pieces at the Keirokai. But it has never been presented to the English-speaking part of our Japanese community. So the JCL, we're going to take the responsibility to do that. But your question of the needs survey, which Mrs. Koizumi also referred to, is that the next survey has to be much more specific, right? About mm-hmm. as a follow-up to the results from this initial survey. We are now talking with members, JA members, and we're beginning to glean out what are the more specific needs that we need to take a look at. So we do need to do a more thorough needs, individual more needs survey.
General portion is very, very important, but at the same time, something divided in the subsection.
Right.
Like what about your medical concern, et cetera,
right.
based on the finding in the survey.
Right.
Then housing, et cetera. So we could easily drive the next follow-up action.
Right. This past week, again at the JAA, we had a senior week that lasted 10 days. And through many of those senior week activities, we had quite an active schedule. Through those events, there were questionnaires given out that needs to be tabulated now. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming.
It's great having you.
So we would like to thank you, two health experts, Dr. Koizumi and Dr.
No, I'm not a doctor.
Ms.
Just playing.
Yamaguchi, for coming in tonight.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.